What's up, YouTube? Welcome back to the channel. We are in the laboratory today to talk some fantasy football because the free agency has been absolutely out of control this year. Maybe we say that every year. I don't really know. But I feel like it's been a lot more wild this year than it's ever been. And that's because there's so many players on the market. There's so many people signing with new teams. And I think we need to get into it now before everyone kind of forgets about it, right? So what I want to do is, because there's been so many different signings, I want to make a video, break it down by position. So today I want to get into the wide receiver position specifically, only because the running back landscape hasn't been settled yet. There's still Jamal Charles, Adrian Peterson, a couple others that haven't signed with any teams yet. So I want to do the wide receivers because it seems like the dust has kind of settled in that position. If you want to keep seeing this fantasy football stuff roll out through the offseason, you know, make sure you give that thumbs up, comment down below what more you'd like to see in the coming weeks when it comes to the draft, when it comes to free agency, all those kind of things. Any engagement is appreciated down below. That being said, let's get into it. Hey. So I got my notes up on the screen here. You're kind of in the corner. I got my computer up in here. So if I'm looking up there, it's just because I'm looking at my notes that I've written down to get, my brain. There is something up there, I promise. Get that moving a little bit. So I'm just going to go down the list of receivers that have kind of moved. First up on the list is B. Marsh, some guy I was like super high on last year. I'm talking about like cocaine high on him last year. And he moved this offseason from the New York Jets to the G-Men. B. Marsh obviously had a terrible year last year. Wasn't good, and I apologize for anyone who drafted him because of my ass. So he moved from the Jets to the Giants, who have Eli Manning throwing the football. I'm not saying Eli Manning's elite, but he's much, 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 much more competent than any quarterback Marshall had throwing him the ball last year. Now, Marshall came out and said he is the 2A, he's the 2A to Sterling Shepard's 2B to Odell Beckham being the one. He knows his role. He understands that Odell's still the guy there. And I think that bodes well for the team. And I think that this is going to be a huge, huge year for that offense for Odell and Brandon Marshall together in terms of fantasy perspective. Now, Brandon Marshall last year, I came across a ridiculous stat that only 44% of the targets he got were deemed catchable. Like, let that sink in. So if he saw 100 targets, only 44 of them were even in the vicinity of him being able to catch the ball. Like, what kind of numbers do you expect him to put up with that kind of shit thrown his way? Like, it's out of control. And now he moves over to Eli Manning, who is not in the prime of his career anymore, but he's still a much, much better quarterback than what he was working with. And I'm not worried about the target share. They're a high passing volume offense. You know, they're always three wide receiver sets, so all three of those guys are going to be on the field all the time. Odell's still going to be that elite guy over the top, 10, 15 targets a game. Now, B. Marsh, interestingly, is really going to be the first red zone target Eli's had since, like, Plaxico Burress. You know, the jump up, can do the fade, can beat guys that are smaller than him. Normally, they just kind of, force it into Odell, force it into their shorter guys. They don't have a good tight end weapon, really. And B. Marsh kind of provides that to the offense, something that they've been lacking for a while. So I really like the idea that his touchdown total is gonna shoot up a lot this year. So I think he's a solid wide receiver, too, there in the Giants offense. So to conclude with B. Marsh, I think he's going to be a really, really solid wide receiver, too, fantasy purposes. I think next on the list has to naturally be the little boy out of New Orleans, Brandin Cooks, moves from one Hall of Fame quarterback to another, from Drew Brees to Tom Brady. This is like one of the crazier moves that I feel like has happened in the NFL in the past couple off seasons. And it's because, let's break it down. I think when you're looking at this, there's a lot to take in before you start making your opinion on it, So I think from one side, you see Brandin Cooks, right? He's like this 23-year-old kid, that back-to-back really productive seasons, his 4.3 speed that he could just blow the top, give him a 5-yard dump off, he'll take it 80 yards, right? And he's get to play with the GOAT quarterback in Brady this year. What can go wrong, right? Locked in wide receiver one, wide receiver two. But there's another side to the story. He's got a piece of the pie here, fellas. Good morning. So, you know, you look at New England, and they got like 47,000 pieces in that offense already. They have Gronk. They got Dwayne Allen, who they brought in. They got Malcolm Mitchell, Chris Hogan, Julian Edelman. They have Deion Lewis, James White, and their newly signed Rex Burkhead. Yo, don't sleep on my boy Rexy Sexy Burkhead. Good pass catcher, but you get what I'm saying. They got a ton of weapons there. So it's like, where does Brandin Cooks even fit into that offense? And it's like, yo, wait, but it's Aaron Dobson's here to break out though, right? I can't wait for those articles to start popping up for the fourth straight offseason. No, but in all seriousness, he's in Arizona, so we won't have to read those articles anymore. And speaking of Arizona, maybe they'll bring Michael Floyd bike, another weapon to compete with. So Brady's going to have to throw the ball like 77 times for everyone on this offense to eat, is basically what I'm saying, which isn't really out of control, I guess, when you think about how their offense runs and they threw it like 55 times a game last year. You know, there's a lot of pieces to the puzzle. And you're thinking, like, why bring Brandin Cooks in when you already have Julian Edelman, like a really productive slot receiver, right? Now, there's a couple ways you could look at this, right? Edelman's under contract until the end of this year, until the end of 2017. So you could say this is a long-term play, right? Like, Cooks is going to be the next slot guy. He's the heir to the slot. Yo. Great TV idea right there. It's like a fight to be the little white slot receiver in New England. It's like Game of Thrones where you fight for the throne, but you fight for the like Wes Welker, Julian. Dude, this is a, yo. I want someone who did like the. You remember those like the NBA playoff? They did like the Game of Thrones YouTube videos, and they'd like have Tim Duncan as like a White Walker or whoever it was as like White Walkers and shit. Whoever did that needs to do like a mock-up of the little white slot receivers in New England. And I know Brandin Cooks is black, whatever. Let's get back to the point. So this might be a long-term play for Brandin Cooks, right? He might be next year's slot receiver or something like that. But you know, New England knows what they're doing. I'm not sold on that idea, but when you dig deeper into the numbers, they're two different players. They play two different positions, realistically. Edelman ran about 54-55% of his routes from the slot last year, and that's a number he's been consistently around, while Brandin Cooks was around 64-65% of his slots, his routes, on the outside. So, realistically, he's going to be competing more so with Chris Hogan. He's not competing with them. He's going to be taking snaps away from Chris Hogan, Malcolm Mitchell, and those guys, not Julian Edelman. So, you know, I don't think it's an Edelman versus Cooks kind of thing here. I also want to throw in a couple weird, interesting facts that I found the last couple of days from my research. Brandin Cooks has never played a game in weather under 55 degrees. How weird is that? I don't know if that stat is weirder or the fact that someone researched enough to find out that stat. I'm not sure which is weirder there. But that's interesting because, you know, a young player like Cooks coming over to New England now goes from a nice, cozy turf and dome to Foxborough where they just, like, eat snow for breakfast, right? And I think as someone who's not maybe mentally prepared and who hasn't played in those conditions, literally never played in under 55 degrees, that's going to be a little bit of a wake-up call for him. And he's not someone who performs particularly well on the road. His production has dipped by like 25%, which is a product of probably Drew Brees' production also dipping. But you get what I'm saying. It's going to be a new environment for him to adapt to. So I wouldn't be surprised if he started off pretty slow there in New England. Another really interesting fact was New England, the last time they had a wide receiver have more than two games of 100 receiving yards in a single season was back in 2012 when Wes Welker did it. So in 4 years, they haven't had a receiver have at least three games of 100 yards, which, I mean, it's not crazy when you think about it because of the amount of times they throw the tight ends, and their tight ends are always their best pass catchers. So just keep that in mind. I guess my overall takeaway is that, you know, it's a tricky situation. Cooks is no doubt super talented. He's going to have his huge games, like monster games. Wouldn't be surprised if he caught games where, you know, he had 13, 15, 17 receptions in those games. But he's also going to have some big bust games. And I think he's going to be priced a little too high for me to go all in on Cooks. I'm not really sure what his ADP is looking like now. If I had to guess where his ADP is going to be by season start, I would say like mid to late 20s. So like back end of round three. And I think that's a little too wealthy for me, you know. Bill and those boys just don't give a shit about fantasy football, man. They're about that hardware. They're about them rings. Moral of the story is draft Tom Brady, to be honest with you, with all those fucking weapons. So let's move over to Alshon Jeffery. Another big move, another really talented player who signed a one-year kind of prove-it deal in Philadelphia. He moves over to the Eagles, who also signed Torrey Smith. And now they kind of went from having no receiving core to a pretty good stack of weapons over there for Carson Wentz to work with. They have Alshon Jeffery, Torrey Smith on the outside. They have Jordan Matthews and now Zach Ertz. Well, they've had Zach Ertz, but I mean, well, collectively, they have those four good pass catchers all together. Now, the Eagles actually ranked sixth in pass attempts last year, which was surprising to me. So they're a high-volume offense, and Jeffrey's obviously going to benefit from the targets there. He's going to be the number one passing option, no doubt, on the outside. And the amount of talent he has, we're just waiting for that masterpiece of the season to kind of come out of Jeffery. And who knows if it's going to come. He needs that formula. He needs the health plus the production to stay, you know, to hit that ceiling that we know he has. Now the question is he going to do that with Philly? My instinct is it's not going to be this year. I think that putting all these new weapons around Carson Wentz and changing the dynamic of the offense is going to take time for a young guy like Carson to adapt to, and he's going to have to build chemistry with these new receivers. You know, it's not like Madden where you just plug guys in and now that his speed was increased. You know, you take this guy out, put in a guy who's 95 speed, and the deep ball is perfect now, right? It takes chemistry. These are real things that factor into the football games, right? So I just think the new group is going to take Carson Wentz because he's young, a little time to adapt to. And I don't see a monster season out of Jeffery, and I think he's going to be drafted again, probably where Brandin Cooks is. It's an interesting ADP factor there to see where they go. I think he'll be, you know, late round three as well. And would I take Jeffery over Cooks? I would go Cooks there, I think. But I think, would I? No, I think I'd go Jeffery, actually, because Jeffrey's the clear number one there. And that's about the spot where I'd probably be comfortable picking him, probably late 20s, early 30s. But enough about Alshon Jeffery. Let's move over to Terrell Pryor. Just another, see, I swear, dude, these moves like get better and better as the free agency wears on. Another really interesting move here, another one-year prove-it deal. He moves from the Browns over to the Redskins. Now, this is assuming Kirk Cousins is 100% back with the Skins, so we're going to analyze it that way. Last year, Pryor had a very good year. He was able to hit 1,000 yards with six different shitty quarterbacks in Cleveland. Now he gets Kirk Cousins, right? You look at the Redskins situation, and they have a lot of really good talent there, a lot of young talent that you say might eat up targets. You have Jameson Crowder coming up, Jordan Reed, their first-round rookie, Josh Doctson might actually decide to suit up and play this year. Who knows? He might dabble on the field. So, you know, you're going in and you're saying like, hey, maybe Pryor is going to have to share a lot more than you think. They also lost D-Jax and they also lost Pierre Garçon. Both guys had over 100 targets. Both guys had over 1,000 yards. That's a lot of opportunity for Jeffery to make up. I mean, for Terrell Pryor to jump in on there, right? Ooh, so I've got like a pulled. My trap hurts. So I guess the way I'm looking at this is when comparing Pryor to other guys and if you should draft him over others, the one big takeaway I had from last year that I'll probably preach all offseason is when you're deciding between two wide receivers, you should almost always err on the side of the guy with the better quarterback. Look at the top 10 fantasy wide receivers last year. You have Jordy, Mike Evans, Antonio Brown, Odell Beckham, Julio, Michael Thomas, Brandin Cooks, Doug Baldwin, Davante Adams. Those are like the top 10 guys, I think, right? Look at every single one of those names and what they all have in common. Really good quarterbacks, if not elite quarterbacks, throwing them the ball. With the possible exception of Mike Evans having Jameis Winston, depending on how you view Jameis Winston. But Mike Evans led the league in targets last year for all receivers, so that really didn't matter, right? Because he had enough volume to prove it otherwise. So every one of those guys was in the top 10, had really good quarterbacks throwing them the ball. Now, obviously, you're going to have guys like Allen Robinson, DeAndre Hopkins, who break out and have that elite talent, right, with shitty quarterbacks. But I think what last year proved is that it's almost nearly impossible to stay that high, highly productive, consistently with the shitty quarterback at the helm. So I think, and I'm not saying Kirk Cousins is elite, but in terms of fantasy production, he's getting there, dude. He is getting there. He had almost 5,000 yards passing last year. What I'm saying is, you know, the prior Cousins connection can be really, really good. And that's going to be interesting to see, you know, the ADP of Pryor versus Cooks versus Jeffery. And to be honest with you, I think I might take Terrell Pryor over both of those guys. I heard an interesting comparison between Terrell Pryor to Brandon Marshall. I think that's a good one. I think in terms of like the catch radius and athleticism and things like that, I think that was a good comparison. Okay, let's move over to Kenny Britt, the guy who replaced Terrell Pryor. They didn't re-sign Terrell Pryor, so they went out and signed Britt to a four-year, $32 million deal. Now, Britt went over 1,000 yards. He had a quiet, really good season last year. And I know people are like, you know, he always had that potential. He always was super athletic, super prototypical in terms of his build, and people were kind of waiting for him to bust out. I wouldn't consider last year a bust out season or anything. He's been in the league for a while now. But, you know, he did that with some really shitty quarterback play in St. Louis, so there's no reason to think he can't do it again in Cleveland. What I think I like most about this deal is, you know, when you're looking at, you're like, oh, Kenny Britt's kind of old, you know, I don't want to draft him. Terrell Pryor is only, he's less than a year younger than Kenny Britt. They're not that far apart in age, which was crazy to me when I looked at that. But I really like Hugh Jackson being there in Cleveland. I think he works well with his receivers, and he's able to work with the production he had. You know, he did it in Cincinnati with A.J. Green. He did it last year with Terrell Pryor. I think he's going to be able to do it with Kenny Britt. And that money they gave him says the same thing, that they think they're going to be able to do that. You know, they might go out in the draft and pick up that, what is that quarterback? I haven't really looked at the college landscape yet. Trubisky, whatever his name is. He might be the quarterback, so that's a big upgrade for Kenny Britt. I like him and Coleman this year, to be honest with you. So I think Britt's going to go underdrafted, and I think he's someone you could get for a cheap price. Who else we got on this list? I'm just going to run down here. So we got Teddy Ginn. So Teddy Ginn moves over to the Dome in division rivals. He moved over from Carolina to New Orleans. And now Brandin Cooks has gone to New Orleans, so they needed another deep threat, right? I feel like Ginn was used perfectly in that Carolina offense, right? I feel like every time you saw him on highlights, it was just deep bombs. And Cam Newton consistently just threw it up. And I feel like you're going to see a lot of the same. And I feel like you're gonna see a lot of that in New Orleans with Ted Ginn. He's consistently been at, it was 97 targets last year, 95 the year before that. And all three starting wide receivers for the Saints had 104 targets or more last year. So safe to say that Ted Ginn will be at about 100 targets, right? And, you know, he's in the Dome. He's going to be able to fly by defenders. He has Drew Brees throwing him the ball. So there's no reason to think that he can't put up the numbers that he put up last year or the season prior. But despite, like, the hype and everyone saying he had such a big year, Ginn finished as wide receiver 46 last season. So let's not get ahead of ourselves. I'm not saying he's got wide receiver 2 upside. I'm saying he's someone you can get for basically nothing in your draft and, you know, provide you with those big games. So definitely a move I like for the Saints. Next, we have Robert Woods. Oh, my God. I literally can't take anything else about Robert Woods. The guy, he had a good year in Buffalo. Literally came out and said, I'm okay with being, you know, he's like, I'm the number two to Sammy Watkins. I'm fine with playing the second piece. And now people are like, oh, he's the only, so he moved over to the Rams, and he's the only piece there, so he's going to get wide receiver one type targets and shit like that. I'm like, dude, but Robert Woods is not a talented wide receiver by any means. He's a good role player, right? He'll never be the alpha dog. You ask 25 of the top wide receivers, you know, like, you think you could take over the top spot and be the alpha dog in that offense, and every single one of them will be like, yep. Robert Woods, nope, I'm okay being, I like being the number two. I mean, being the number two in the shittiest offense in the NFL. Like, nah. He's a good blocker. I think that's a piece of why they brought him in for Gurley's purposes. This overall is just a move that's getting far too much attention for me. I'll get Robert Woods if he's going late in the draft, but otherwise I'm sticking away from that dude. Kenny Stills re-signed in Miami. Another move that's getting a lot of hype, and I kind of think it's unwarranted. I think this move was made for a few reasons. I think it was for continuity in the offense. You know, for Ryan Tannehill's purposes to grow, I guess. Also interesting because Adam Gase, I don't know if it was at the Combine or where it was, but he was talking about Devontae Parker. And it was like in a tone where he was like saying, you know, do you think Devontae Parker is going to produce this year or whatever? And he's like, oh, he's got to show up to meetings on time first. So he's talking down Devontae Parker a lot, which, you know, inversely obviously affects Kenny Stills as the wide receiver one there possibly. And I'm not comfortable just drafting Stills off of speculative statistics and like what you think he's going to be. He's super young. He's fast. And he had a good year last year. He had 9 touchdowns last year, right? So here's what kind of bugs me about that. So he had 9 touchdowns, and 6 of them came in the final 8 games, right? So he had 6 touchdowns in the last 8 weeks of the season. Really good numbers, right? When you look at that, only one player had more touchdowns in that span, which was Jordy Nelson at 7. In that span, Kenny Stills was wide receiver 24. Barely broke the... If you play in a 12-team league, he's a wide receiver 2. If you're in a 10-team league like myself, he's a wide receiver 3 there. So you're going to put up almost a touchdown a game for 8 weeks and be a wide receiver 3? Like, that's shitty. Jordy Nelson was wide receiver 1 over that span. 3 other guys, Antonio Brown, Dez, and Devontae Adams, all had 6 touchdowns over that same span as Kenny Stills, and they were all top 10 fantasy wide receivers. So that, I don't know. That's just those numbers, you know, if you're going to put up 6 touchdowns in 8 games, double that to 12 touchdowns, that's like his ceiling, I would say. And that puts you as wide receiver 24, and that's almost guaranteed touchdown regression. Like, I'm not sold on Stills cracking anything big this year. Take that for what it's worth, but I think by the time the drafts come around, there'll probably be a lot of hype behind him and Devontae Parker. I'd assume they're probably going to go 1 to 2 rounds apart, and I'd probably avoid both of them, to be honest with you. But I don't know. I'm kind of sticking away from Stills this year. He's probably a guy I need to look into a little more because a lot of people like him and I don't. Whatever. Oh, God, this list just goes on of dudes I hate. Torrey Smith in Philadelphia. Like, we kind of touched on him, but not really. 27 years old. I'm good on Torrey Smith. It's the same story basically every year. Oh, this is his year to break out. This is his year he's gonna do huge things because he's so fast, right? Every year was... The year prior, he was just in a bad situation. But this year, nah, I'm good. It's the same story every year. He never puts up those elite numbers. Sure, he's had years where he puts up 1,000 yards, done it a few times. Not going to expect huge numbers in that Eagles offense when they already have Jordan Matthews, Zach Ertz, and Alshon Jeffery. So I'm good on Torrey Smith. That's going to be a hard no for me, dog. Enough of dudes that I hate. Let's move on to a move that I low-key actually really like. Pierre Garçon to the 49ers. Now, Pierre Garçon quietly had a really good year last year. Let me see these stats if I have them written down. He caught 79 balls, so almost 80 catches, and he went for 1,041 yards. That's a really good PPR year. That's what he did last year in the Redskins offense. Now, he moves over to the 49ers, who signed Brian Hoyer. I'm not really sure where the quarterback situation is going to be. If it's Hoyer, they're still talking to Kaepernick. Are they going to draft somebody? Whatever. But they got Kyle Shanahan from the Falcons. And Shanahan obviously does wonders with quarterback. But that's not why I like it. I like it because Garçon and Shanahan played together in Washington in 2013. Not played together, obviously. Shanahan was the coordinator for him. And, you know, he always has that X receiver, and Garçon was the X receiver for him in 2013, and he put up 113 receptions, 1,346 yards, and 5 touchdowns. Now, he's going to be like the only receiver in... Sorry, I got to scratch my ass real quick. He's going to be the only receiver in that Niners offense, right? He's going to play that big role for Shanahan. So he's going to see a ton of targets. I'm not saying I see him putting up wide receiver two numbers, but he's definitely a really good pick late in the draft, especially if you're in PPR leagues. So look at my fingernail, yo. I don't know if you're going to... It's going to like focus. Maybe if I get my face out. So I slammed weights on it the other day, right? And now it's coming up, like, there's space between it. It's like bruised, and it's space between my nail and my actual finger. It's going to fall off soon. I'm terrified. Whatever. Get down. I think I only have a couple more left, which is cool because I got to get to editing this video. This is the worst part about doing this channel is the editing, man. I can't stand it. I love producing the content. I love doing this shit, but... Then when I gotta upload it, it takes 25 minutes. You gotta go through every second and like take shit out and then upload that to an application and then upload it to YouTube. It takes like fucking 5 hours. It's unbelievable. Next, I wanna talk about Chicago, because they're making a couple moves. They brought in Marcus Wheaton and Kendall Wright. Like, what the fuck goes on in that front office? I wanna be there and listen to what they talk about. They gave Marcus Wheaton a bigger contract than Brandon Marshall got in New York. So, this team is going to struggle this year, man. Wilson, if you watch this video, one of my friends is a Bears fan. You suck, bro. You suck. Next year is going to be tough for you. You know, they have Mike Glennon at quarterback coming in, which is an uncertainty. I can't imagine, for fantasy perspective, it can be that much better than Hoyer or Cutler last year. They have four potential receivers who could break out, or, you know, we don't even know how the landscape's going to work out for them four. You got Kevin White coming back, Cameron Meredith, now these two, Marcus Wheaton and Kendall Wright coming in. To be honest, I'm probably passing on all four of those guys. There is one guy, however, that I do like, and that is Cameron Meredith out of those four. If I had to choose one, definitely Meredith. Meredith had some really, really good games last year. Now, out of... every receiver in the NFL, right? Only 9 receivers finished. Why is this light going on? I don't know. I'm going to come up real close to tell you this. Only 9 receivers in the NFL last year had 5 weeks in which they were a wide receiver one. So a top 10 finish as a wide receiver in fantasy. Cameron Meredith is one of those 9 guys. Finished as wide receiver 3, wide receiver 10, wide receiver 8, wide receiver 6, and wide receiver 4. And over the last 4 weeks of the season, he was actually wide receiver 2 overall, only behind Jordy Schmnelson. It's kind of crazy when you think about it. Cameron Meredith, he can play. He can ball. Boy can ball. So I'm looking at Meredith. Y'all keep my eye on Meredith. I think that wraps up the wide receivers. If I missed anyone, let me know in the comments, and I'll let you know what I think. I'll do some digging, get some cool stats for y'all. Otherwise, I hope you enjoyed this kind of format of the video, and next episode will probably be tight ends. There's a lot of good tight end movements. So if you enjoyed, please let me know in the comment section. Give the thumbs up, please. I'm going to be putting a blog version of this video onto my website, bdgeat.com. Everything will be linked below in the description. Please give me that thumbs up. Subscribe to the channel if you're new and you enjoyed. And that's really it. You can go follow me on the Twitter. So I have 2 Twitters. I have one specifically for fantasy football. I'll link it below and I'll put it on the screen like right now. And if you haven't checked out, we did mock drafts. We did 2 mock drafts, round 1 and 2, already on the channel. They're posted. Go back and look at my older videos for next season. So that's kind of interesting. And that's it. I'll see y'all next time. Have a good day, have a good week, have a good year. Kicking mouth closed. We smoking Indo, Alto, and Palo Alto. If this party ain't got hoes, my intro's my outro. Can't stop, can't stop.